Shalom, Mashamcha, Mashlameh. Greetings, peace, Nihal. Womasta, oneness, and any other salutation you may like. Warning, the following video, the forthcoming information, contains strong language, which may be offensive to some viewers, and or inappropriate for children. The content within this video is intended for mature audiences only. Proceed at your own risk. I'm a right knowledge terrorist. I'm a truth gangster. And I'm at war with falsehood and with the status quo. I do not consent to the political social norms of effeminizing masculinity. I'm a spokesman for men and women that love them. I warn listeners that I often ignite a storm of controversy through dynamic, emotional speech making, which is a force for positive change, empowerment, and cultural pride. United States of America and listeners throughout the world, consider yourselves warned. There's been a lot of talk by Kamala Harris, Democratic Party. A Negro loves a lie. And that's not the way I want to word that. But because of censorship, and because you get your panties all in a wad if I speak truth, I have to use substitute words like Negro. But that's not the way I want to say that. Because you're actually not Negroes. You're something else, and you know what you are. An N-word loves a lie. And the Democratic lie, you've loved that throughout history. So let me talk to you briefly about Democrats and the Jim Crow, which is a century, 100 years of racism. You're free to republish this video all over the world. I, Kahan Tazadaq, give you that consent. My only requirement is that you give Kahan Tazadaq the shout out and credibility and send them to this channel. Spread the word. This is right knowledge for real. It's not that knowledge is power. It's right knowledge, and the application of right knowledge is power. Now let me talk. In a recent sit down that Mr. Donald Trump had with a black woman by the name of Scott, he was pretty much ridiculed in the previous election when Trump ran. He was pretty much denounced amongst black voters. He scored approximately 4% of the black female, emphasis added, voters. And a whooping 13% of the black male votes. That was the highest since Richard Nixon. This isn't shocking. Black voters have voted in the masses for the Democrat Party since the mid-60s. I have to address this issue, because they're giving praises to a woman that throughout her career that has again and again referred to herself as an Indian. But now that is convenient, and she needs the black vote to secure a position as the president of the United States. There's photos of her eating watermelon. chicken, which is really making a mockery of you. But a Negro loves a lie. You love a lie. What? So the black voters has been going out in the masses for this very same party that had them in slavery. The very same party from which the Ku Klux Klan derived. So the itsy bitsy spider. The 1964 Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, and the social welfare programs of the Great Society. Since these things, you blacks have been riding the Democratic wave. This really solidified you black voters behind the Democratic Party. But it also made you complacent. But they've been moving there since the New Deal. But how can you ignore its historical anatomy in the United States? The traditional home of the black voter was the Republican Party. Due to the historical role of the Republican Party ending slavery. I mean, this is, a Negro loves a lie. It was the Republican Party that introduced Reconstruction, and because you was doing so well in Reconstruction, it was the Democratic Party that created the Ku Klux Klan, burned down your businesses, burned down Black Wall Street, rape, ravish your women, lynch your men and children. But since a Negro loves a lie, you get out and vote. In 2024, for the Democratic Party. Shame on you. Shame on you. What is wrong with you? So the Reconstruction Act, these Reconstruction Acts was passed by the Republican Party. And the amendments to the Constitution was passed by the Republican Party. It also did not help that the Democratic Party was the party of Jim Crow. Jim Crow. Oh, what? Some of you young folks in your 20s may not even be aware of Jim Crow. Huh? So if you're unlearned on the Jim Crow, let me enlighten you a little bit. Jim Crow was a system of legal enforced segregation presented throughout the American South in the aftermath of the Civil War. But Tazadaq, what do you mean by Jim Crow? See, before developing further into the topic, it's important to define, for me to clearly define what is meant by Jim Crow and why it is distinct. It's really a distinct form of legal codes. Also referred to as Christian black codes, right? These legal codes in the United States. See, while northern and western cities were by no means integrated, this integration was de facto, not de jure. Huh? See, in many cases, the discrimination in the north was a discrimination of custom and preference discrimination that could not be removed without a highly intrusive government action ensuring equality of the outcome. But northerners and westerners were not required to discriminate, but nor were they forbidden from doing such. Now compare this to the series of laws in the American South known as the mandating segregation at everything from public schools to water fountains. No one is entirely sure where the term Jim Crow came from, right? But it's suspected that it comes from an old mysterious show song and dance routine called Jump Jim Crow. Curiously, the political party application of the term Jim Crow was applied to the white populist supporters of President Andrew Jackson. The history of Jim Crow phenomenon we are discussing here goes back to the end of the Reconstruction in the United States. See, with the Reconstruction era, let me give some brief history on that. Well, Reconstruction was the means by which the federal government reasserted control over the southern states that had previously succeeded to form the Confederate States of America. Now, this involved a military occupation and the disenfranchisement of the bulk of the whole white population of the southern states. The results of the Reconstruction era was mixed. So ultimately, Reconstruction ended as a part of bargaining with President Wilford B. Hayes. And in the White House, after the 1876 election, so the lasting results of Reconstruction are based on enumerated for our purpose as the Reconstruction Amendment. Well, the 13th Amendment abolished involuntary servitude for anyone other than criminals. So if you commit a crime, you do the time. It was once voted down and passed only through the extensive political maneuvering on the behalf of President Abraham Lincoln himself and the approval of the Boer's Reconstruction state government in the South. So it became law in December 1865. Now, the 14th Amendment includes a number of provisions that often thought to be part of the Bill of Rights, such as the Equal Protection Clause and the Due Process Clause, which are in fact later innovations. Most of you don't know that because you don't study law. One of the requirements of every American should be to know the law and to know the Bible. I digress. Birthright citizenship literally advocates claim that the constitutional justification can be founded in this sparring amendment, which also includes amendments barring former Confederate officials from office and addresses Confederate war debts. This amendment became law in 1868. A lot of unlearned patriots claim that the 14th Amendment was never ratified. It became law in 1868. The 15th Amendment prevents discrimination against voters on the basis of race or skin color. This law was quickly circumvented by a number of laws discriminating against all voters on the basis of income, poll tax, or education, literacy test, The southern states eventually figured out how to prevent black citizens, because a Negro loves a lie, from voting while allowing white ones through grandfather clauses. But you vote for him today. You want to be a Democrat. Everybody's screaming Harris. Harris was not a part of this history. The Reconstruction Amendment were the first amendments to the Constitution passed in almost 60 years and represented a significant expansion of federal powers. Now perhaps I contend that the most important thing to know about the Reconstruction Amendment is that they were largely ineffective. Ranking public officials on the Confederacy were elected to the federal government. Blacks was disenfranchised as quickly as they was elected to the Senate. And Jim Crow, what did I say? Jim Crow. An entire system of legal discrimination was erected to return black Americans to their subservient status, with the exception of citizenships for blacks and an end to involuntary servitude. The substance of the rest of the amendments were largely disregarded. So the itsy bitsy the process of black disenfranchisement at the end of the war is important, very important historical context for understanding the rise of Jim Crow. See, it's important to discuss this period without discussing the role of the Ku Klux Klan that no one wants to talk about, and other Democratic Party allies, white supremacist terrorist organization. The Ku Klux Klan was and still is a Democratic Party allied white supremacist terrorist organization. You can read about the lengthy history in many books. See, the first attempt to roll back the gains made by black Americans thanks to the Reconstruction Amendment was a poll tax introduced by Georgia. That's right, Georgia. And to those of you that do not know, the second chapter of the Ku Klux Klan was started in Atlanta, Georgia. But this poll tax was introduced in the state of Georgia in 1877. The legal rollback of voting rights, in particular, did not really ramp up until the turn of the century, when the Republicans ran a joint ticket with the Insurgent People Party, also known as the Pluralist Party. Do you understand? So this threat to the intact Democratic political party, that's your Kamala Harris, that's your Joe Biden. In fact, Joe Biden has called you the N-word in the past. What would you like? Need to go and pull the clips on that as well? And all the Patreons that came with it. See, while certainly related to the racial question, it was arguably a bigger motivator than race. See, in many cases, such as with your poll tax, there was explicit attempts to exclude white voters sympathetic to the Republican cause alongside the black voters. The specter of unity between poor blacks and poor whites loomed large. Mississippi drafted a new constitution in 1890, which required payment of a poll tax as well as passing of a literacy test as a qualification of vote. Shout out to Richard Birch, a Mississippian. This passed the constitutional muster in 1898 with Williams versus Mississippi. Other southern states quickly drafted new constitutions modeled on that of Mississippi. Crooked letter I. This was known as a Mississippi plan. Go check it out for yourself, Richard Birch. I'm giving you some history. I never lived there. But I'm one who knows. A seer, an enlightener. Just listen and you will be deprogrammed and enlightened. Now just be quiet and you just may learn something. So by 1908, every southern state had either drafted a new constitution or passed a suffrage amendment to better craft the state electoral rate to their liking. Moors don't know this. Moors never talk about this because I'm one who's sent with right knowledge. I'm a right knowledge terrorist. I'm a truth gangster. And you should know the truth, and the truth will make you mad. Then if you get over your anger, make you free. Giggle, giggle. 1903. Giles versus Harris strengthened the federal court support of such laws. Huh? By 1908, every southern state either drafted a new constitution or passed a suffrage amendment to better craft that state electoral to their liking. Another method of maintaining control was the white primary. See, this is your Democratic Party. This is your Kamala Harris and company. This is your Obama and company. 1923, Texas became the first state to establish primary voting for whites only. Yeah, Terrence, that's your hometown. What about it, Wilm West? This was quickly deemed unconstitutional. So the state simply drafted a new law saying that the Democratic Party could determine its own voters for the primary. The state partly quickly moved to exclude all non-white voters, which were entirely legal and constitutional because the Democratic Party was a private organization. Do you understand? I'm a private creditor. Most of you debtors don't understand, overstand, or understand what I'm talking about when I say private. This caught the eye of some congressmen. So by the 1900s, there was a discussion of stripping the southern states of some of the congressional representation in accordance with the provisions contained within the Reconstruction Amendment. Not only was the South itself a large voting bloc due to the one-party nature of the many southern elections, but they were also in charge of a goodly number of committee chairs, meaning that any attempt to strip the southern states of seats was probably going precisely nowhere. Reliably, statistics from the era are few and far between. But historians believe that somewhere between 1 and 5% of eligible black voters were registered by the late 1930s. Very few of these actually voted in general election, which were a foregone conclusion. See, in many states, prior to those that actually voted in general elections, which were a foregone conclusion, in many states prior to the first and second Great Migration, the black population ranged upward of close to 50%. Five border states, Delaware, Maryland, West Virginia, Kentucky, and Maryland, all attempted to pass similar legislations to the Mississippi plan, but failed to do so. Redeemer government and elections in 1878. Americans in the South were political precursors for Jim Crow. So in addition to the legal disenfranchisement, there was also a parliamentary actions against both black Americans and Republican voters and candidates. It was not uncommon for the Democratic Party that allied prior military groups to simply force the Republican candidates or even office holders out of town. Voter fraud was also a tool. It's still going on now. It's going on now. It happened with Trump in the last election. As elections became closer, violence against blacks and Republicans increased to keep them away from the polls. This is the history of Democrats. But a Negro loves a lot. I say a Negro loves a lot. These southern governments, also known collectively as the Redeemer Government, they ruled over most of the South from 1870 to 1910. So as we discussed our history of militias in the United States, the white pro-democratic party militias of the South were largely obsolete by the end of the 19th century. The Democratic Party state governments were doing their jobs for them. All of this was facilitated by the Compromise of 1877, or the Corrupt Bargain of 1877. Depending on one point of view, in exchange for certifying Southern votes for Republican candidates, Rufford B. Hayes agreed to remove federal troops from Florida, South Carolina, and Louisiana, the final states where they remained. Hayes campaigned on doing this prior to the bargain. the appointment of one or more Southerners to Haig's cabinet. This was fulfilled by David M. Key from Tennessee as the Postmaster General. Now let me remind you that the Ku Klux Klan had its beginning in Tennessee. The first chapter of the Ku Klux Klan came out of Tennessee. A transcontinental railroad passing through the South, using Texas and the Pacific Line, in legislation to industrialize the Southern economy. And finally, the other thing that Haig agreed to was the Northern hands off the South when it came to racial questions. The first two often emphasized, but they're probably the least important part of the compromise. As I stated previously, Haig had already planned to withdraw the remaining troops from the South. The cabinet appointed of the Postmaster General was certainly a bigger deal than it would be today, when far and few people rely upon mail. See, the Post has not been a cabinet level position since the 1970s. The next two are arguably beneficial to everyone in the South, black or white. And in any event, were never intact. It is also worth noting that the compromise was also a way to avoid potential new wave of bloodshed. At that time, it was widely feared that the American politics were going to go the way of Mexico, meaning the military strongmen and the state violence will resolve closely contested elections. In this context, the compromise is rather shrewd, as Haig gave up very little with regard to the first two provisions and never attacked the points 3 and 4. So the final provision is that one must make Jim Crow possible. And so this makes it, historically speaking, perhaps the most significant of the compromise provision. The Democratic Party coup, Wilmington, North Carolina, in Wilmington, North Carolina. The end of Reconstruction and the subsequent disenfranchisement of blacks and poor whites by the Southern Democrat government were not entirely without resistance, but this resistance was met with sharp and swift reprisals. Case in point, in November 1898, when the brother of a Republican candidate tried to collect affidavits from the black voters that they were being prevented from voting, he was savagely beaten by coonies of the local Democratic Party. It was the Democrats that did that, but the Negro loves a lot, and he still believes the Democrats. 4 days of rioting followed, including 13 blacks and at least one white dead and hundreds injured. Same month and year in Wilmington, North Carolina, there was an orgy of violence and an effective coup against the duly elected fusionist government. Blacks represented by Republicans and white represented by populists of the city. Now here, the Democratic Party explicitly called themselves the White Man's Party. I say it again, the Democratic Party called themselves the White Man's Party. Thus, the saying, the man. Forcing whites to join political and labor organizations. People would literally march out of their homes in the middle of the night and forced to sign membership forms under the threat of death. It was Democrats that did this. But you vote Democrats because a Negro loves a lot, but you don't know your history or theirs. Following a speech from the former Democratic Congressman Alfred Moore. Waddle. Red shirts in attendance left the convention hall and began terrorizing black citizens. The eventual election was rife with fraud. The local black newspaper, the Daily Record, was, along with many others around the state, burned to the ground. Weddell led a group of Republican mayors of the town, forcing him and the entire city council to resign at gunpoint. It's the Democrats that did this. Yet you think Kamala is honest? You think Joe Biden is honest? You think Obama is honest? The new city council was installed and elected. Weddell as mayor. The organizers of the coup, Charles Aycock, became the 50th governor of North Carolina as a Democrat. Other participants became the first female senator, Rebecca Felton. Secretary of the Navy, Joseph Daniels. A state senator and U.S. Congressman, John Bellamy, and a state senator and governor of North Carolina, Robert Glenn. House Majority Leaders and Ways and Means Committee Chair, Claude Kitchen, and Congressman and Governor of North Carolina, W.W. Kitchen. Another governor of North Carolina, Cameron Morrison, and Lieutenant Governor Francis Winston. The disenfranchisement leading up to Jim Crow went deeper than simply stripping the right to vote. It also included removing black citizens from juries and preventing them from being eligible to run for public office. But you vote Democrat today because a Negro loves a lie. What were the Jim Crow laws, Tazadaq? Jim Crow laws, for the most part, were relatively simple. Most states, over 30, including those outside of the South, had laws against interracial marriage, a crime known as miscegenation. The remaining laws against this were overturned by the Supreme Court in 1967 in the Loving versus Virginia case. Some states went further than this, such as Florida, which banned both interracial dating and cohabitation, could live together. Schools, restaurants, theaters, cinemas, hotels, and train stations were commonly separated by law. This is your Democratic Party. But sometimes, baseball teams and prisons were segregated by law, as in Georgia, Mississippi, criminalized anti-Jim Crow propaganda. Anyone that went against it, you were locked up. North Carolina banned the sharing of books between blacks and white schools. The Supreme Court upheld Jim Crow's in Presley versus Ferguson. Huh? That upheld Jim Crow was Presley versus Ferguson. The law in question was the 1890 Louisiana law requiring separate train cars for blacks and white passengers. Homer Presley, a mixed race Louisianan. Huh? 7/8 white, 1/8 black, and registered Republican, as most Southern blacks were at that time. You're Republicans. What happened? You got lied to. And a Negro loves a lie. Deliberately forced the issue as a test case. And he bought a first class ticket and boarded the white train car. The train company knew about this in advance. They opposed the law on the grounds that it would actually require them to effectively double the number of train cars without a corresponding increase in passengers. The committee looking to challenge the law hired a private detective with arrest powers to ensure that Plassey would be arrested for violating the train car segregation law and not vagrancy or something else. Presley and his backers lost every decision on the way up to the Supreme Court, which upheld earlier court rulings. And so this led to the doctrine of separate but equal. The legal theory was that public accommodations must be provided to all citizens, but they could be separate, provided that they were of equal equality. The argument among critics was that the separate facilities were never equal. This was a turning point in history of the American jurisprudence. The Supreme Court made Jim Crow the law of the land in any state that wished to do so. So it's important to again reiterate that Jim Crow was and was not. Jim Crow was a state policy demanding segregation from private businesses. It was not a law allowing for a business to discriminate if they wished to. In this respect, it was like a continuation of the slave patrols of old, whereby private citizens were drafted into the militia to hunt for runaway slaves. So as we can see from what I just previously stated, the private business in question did not want to enforce the law, if only for purely economic reasons, but was forced to by the state Democratic apparatus, Democratic Party, but you vote for because a Negro loves a law. The lesser known phenomenon of the Jim Crow era is the sundown town. These are towns where black Americans were simply not allowed to be out after dark. You know what I said? The sundown town. Have your black ass inside before sundown. For the most part, this was overturned when a matter of laws barring black men from a town or even areas of a town did not pass constitutional muster. Some municipalities got around this by appealing to the city planners or real estate professionals. Democrat Woodrow Wilson. Democrat Woodrow Wilson, the segregationist president. Democrat Woodrow Wilson was arguably one of the most transformational presidents in American history. Not only did he pioneer the aggressive interventional what's the word I'm searching for here? Interventionist, I suppose, foreign policy. The latter came to characterize American international relations. He was also the segregation president while he was previously the governor of New Jersey. His personal background was in the American South, Virginia to be exact. Wilson basically walked in the White House during the 1912 election. The Republican Party split between supporters of President William Taft and former President Theodore Roosevelt, who ran on his own progressive party. Taft all but bowed out of the race. Historians has argued that he was more interested in his eventual job as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court than he was in being president. Wilson won 40 states, while the incumbent president won 2. T.R. carried the balance. The 1916 election was much closer in the popular vote, with Wilson irking his way to victory in what was effectively a referendum on whether or not the United States would enter the Great War on the side of Great Britain. But once in power, Wilson's outlook led to him to change the American foreign policy. He argued against using self-interest as a basis for foreign alliance, and instead said foreign policy should be based upon collective security and moral judgment. He led the creation of the League of Nations, the precursor of the United Nations. Wilson is also the first Southerner to occupy the White House since fellow Virginian Zachary Taylor. In 1848, while some argue that the so-called nadir of race relations in America was either earlier or later than Wilson, it's hard to see the Wilson administration is turning point and consolidation of segregation on a national scale. Segregation at the federal level became the law of the land under Wilson. See, while Wilson rejected proposals to segregate every department, he allowed cabinet heads to segregate their own department as they wish. The military segregated, with all black units serving under white officers at equal pay. The first great migration led to a number of race riots, and the Wilson administration did not intervene under the advice of his attorney general. It's worth noting that Wilson personally shared the Lost Cause view of the war between the states. He also saw the Redeemer government as an understandable response to radical Republican rule. Neither of these views are particularly controversial nor in and of themselves racist, but they're worth bringing up due to Wilson's role as the most segregationist president since the end of the Civil War. The Wilson era was also the period of the resurgence of the Ku Klux Klan, the KKK, and the popular film Birth of a Nation. Wilson, for his part, denounced both of these. They're mentioned here only to paint a picture of what race relations was like in America at this time. The summer after Wilson left the White House was known as the Red Summer, due to the number of race riots. Over 165 people were killed. All told, there were 39 race riots throughout the United States between February and October 1919. The African Blood Brothers was formed for the sake of black self-defense during this period, but was quickly taken over by the nascent Communist Party. But the system of segregation began to show cracks. Northern liberals in the Democrat Party, such as Herbert Humphrey, was unwilling to continue to look the other way. President Harry S. Truman, a Democrat from the border state of Mississippi, made inroads against segregation. He appointed the President's Commission on the Civil Rights, which drafted a 10-point plan to advance civil rights. Part of the change in the racial relations had to do with the service of black Americans during the war. Truman himself said, "My forebears were Confederates, but my very stomach turned over when I had learned that Negro soldiers just back from overseas were being dumped out of army trucks in Mississippi and beaten." Truman aggressively pursued a policy of integration and fairness in the military and federal employment, banning racial discrimination in the civil service. There was, of course, a predictable backlash. Southern Democrats was unhappy. Who? Democrats. Southern Democrats was unhappy with Truman's actions on civil rights. They split from the party in 1948, nominating then Democratic Storm Thurmond on the state's rights Democratic Party ticket. They even managed to secure his place on the main Democratic Party line in four states, of which Thurmond won. The only non-Confederate states where Thurmond appeared on the ballot were Kentucky, Maryland, California, North Dakota. Thurmond was considered sometimes or something of a progressive during his time as governor of South Carolina. He personally fought for the arrest of men who lynched Willie R. While no one was ever convicted for the crime, Thurmond was personally thanked for his effort by the NAACP and the ACLU. The purpose was not to win, but rather to force the election to the House of Representatives, where it would start. The Dixiecrats could force concession from either President Truman or New York Governor Thomas Dowie. Thurmond fought a vigorous campaign challenging President Truman to a debate on civil rights questions. He claimed until the day he died that the impetus for his campaign against civil rights was not based on racism, but on opposition to communism. After the campaign, the original plan was to continue the state's rights Democrat Party as an alternative to the regular Democratic Party, but it fell apart when Thurmond realized he could not fully abandon the party. Jim Crow began to fall apart completely in 1954 with the landmark Supreme Court decision Brown versus the Board of Education of Topeka. At the time of the ruling, 20 states forbade racial segregation in public schools, with another 3 making it optional or limited. Only in the old Confederacy as well as Oklahoma, Missouri, Kentucky, West Virginia, Maryland, and Delaware was it mandatory. This was not the end of the story. Democratic Party state government and politicians led by Virginia Senator Harry Byrd coordinated a campaign of massive resistance. In some municipalities, public schools were shuttered entirely rather than allowing black children to attend the schools there. This led to the rise of segregation academies known as private schools, exclusively for white students, which continue legally until 1976. A series of bills were passed between 1957 and 1965 that meant that segregation was all but over, except for the shouting. The first The Civil Rights Act of 1957 was spirited to passage by future President Lyndon Baines Johnson. At that time, the most popular figure in the United States Senate, Storm Thurmond, tried to block it. The longest one-man filibuster in history, 24 hours and 18 minutes. The bill sought to secure voting rights and was largely ineffective. The Civil Rights Act of 1960 followed, further seeking the strengthening minority voting rights in the southern states, as well as to reinforce disintegration. The Civil Rights Act of 1974 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965, along with Brown versus the Board of Education decision, can be seen as the effective end of Jim Crow, legislatively, that is. George Wallace bolted from the Democratic Party and ran for presidency in 1968 explicitly to preserve segregation. Democrats on you again, but a Negro loves the law. This was the famous proclaiming segregation now, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever in his 1963 inauguration address. After he'd been elected governor of Alabama, I believe it's worth noting that Wallace's own support for segregation might have been entirely opportunist. He initially ran for governor of Alabama as a pan-racial pluralist. After losing, he declared, "I will never be outing." How do I say this? "I will never be out N-word again. I will never be out N-word again." And later reflected that, "You know, I tried to talk about good roads, good schools, and all these things that have been part of my career, and nobody listened. And then I began talking about the N-words, and they stormed the floor." Wallace, like Thurmond before him, sought to throw the presidential election to the House. Wallace was at that time governor of Alabama. He had previously run for president in 1964 as a Democrat, as he did again in 1972. But at this time he ran as the standard bearer of the American Independent Party. His unofficial slogan was, "There's not a dime's worth of difference between the two major parties." End of quote. He ran on a law and order and progressive platform, seeking to, as Thurmond did before him, throw the election to the House. Wallace was arguably far more successful than Thurmond. First, he got 46 electoral votes to Thurmond 39. Making him the last third-party candidate to get electoral votes. He also got nearly 10 million votes, 9.9 million compared to Thurmond's 1.1 million. For Thurmond, this was a scant 2.4% of the vote compared to Wallace's 13.5%. While Wallace ran first in the Confederacy with 45% of the votes, he succeeded where Thurmond did not, for making a direct appeal to the northern working class votes. Fully won in three, the AFL and the CIO members supported Wallace in the summer of 68. In September 1968, Wallace was preferred candidate of the Chicago Steelworkers, taking 44% of their support. Soon to be President Richard Nixon, however, with the help of the young Patrick Buchanan, turned the tide. Nixon argued that a vote for Wallace was ultimately a vote for Humphrey. He also hammered away at Alabama being a right-to-work state. While it is often argued that Nixon pursued a Southern strategy. This is false. Nixon's strategy was twofold. He sought to win on the basis of mass turnout from Northern Catholics and the Southern Protestants, the latter category including Southern black voters. While some argue that the de facto segregation still exists, it is not debatable that the de jure segregation was ended in the 1950s and the 1960s. This was done through all alliance of the Liberal Democrats and Republicans. Debate thus continues, however, as to whether some of these legislations championed by Lyndon B. Johnson was merely opportunist in order to secure the black vote for the Democratic Party, like Michelle, like Kamala Harris is trying to do now. It's hard to say what Johnson's motive was. Johnson's strategy has paid off. Black Americans continue to vote in masses for Democrats who have conveniently scrubbed major portions of their party's history from the record books. And since a Negro loves a lie, they can't see the Democrats for what they really are, a party of racism and violence. See, for the part of the Republicans, they simply cannot rely on a 100 plus year history of anti-black racism being the glue that united the Democratic Party to win votes. See, the Democratic Party has delivered for the black communities in a number of ways over the last 50 years, including various civil rights and voting acts, and large amount of cash plumped into the black community via the welfare programs that made them dependents, and giving them government jobs. While I may have discussed this elsewhere, the destructive role that such programs has played in the black community, the black community does not realize, because a Negro loves a lie. Republicans generally don't touch this in their voters' outreach. Instead, they're relying upon lazy arguments about how Democrats are the real racists. It's not even clear that the outreach based on exposing the failure of social programs would work. So I ask all of you blacks under the sound of my voice that love a lie, have not your social programs given to you by the Democrats failed again and again? Look at your predicament. This is a solid argument to be made. The Democrats are still the party of racism. Joe Biden's a racist. He called you the N-word. But that's not the focus of their racism. It has moved from the blacks to working class whites. When you go to the polls, I suggest that you stop lying to yourselves and see the Democrats and the Indian lady Kamala Harris for what they are: liars. And use you as a catalyst to ascertain what they want, and then nothing changed. What will it take to wake you up? I'm Kahan Tazadaq, and this is Right Now It's For Real. Like, share, subscribe. Listen to this message several times so you can get the true meaning of what it is for you to be a Democrat and how naive and stupid you really must be. I'm going to recap. The Klan was started from the Democratic Party. So again, I ask you, how did you go from Republicans to Democrats who enslave you? The same party that wants to deprive one of gun rights. The same party that puts you on welfare to take care of you, just like the slave masters did on the plantation. See, that teaches you to be lazy. That teaches you to not be self-sufficient. And as a result, you're in the conditions that you're in today, because you're consistently looking for handouts. See, the slave owners, the Democrats, they housed, fed, and provided medical care. Look at the paradigm today. You're in the ghettos, there's housing. You're being fed by the former slave owners. This is not being racial, it's realistic, it's history. So it's a necessity to teach you this and why you think the way that you think. The slave owners housed, fed, and provided medical care as they do today. They restrict your movement. Do not move around in large crowds. Forbid you to own firearms. They're attempting to deprive you of a right to own arms. That's the Democratic Party. And they only teach you what you want to know. This is why I was compelled to give you this history of right knowledge. And now, you're Democrats? Are you kidding me? Enter Kamala Harris. As expected, the left is now in histrionics after Donald Trump merely suggested that Kamala Harris might not be black. After he was literally asked a loaded question by an ABC journalist, Rachel Scott, in front of the National Association of Journalists. Now, to recap, Scott asked Trump if he thinks Harris is only on the ticket because she's a black woman, to which Trump replied accurately that Harris has identified as an Indian American, which she openly campaigned on. Let's find the clip.
That Vice President Kamala Harris is only on the ticket because she is a black woman.
Well, I can say no. I think it's maybe a little bit different. So I've known her a long time indirectly, not directly very much, and she was always of Indian heritage.
So you heard for yourselves Rachel Scott's derogatory, nonchalant attempt to call Mr. Trump a liar, when we can see right here with our own eyes that Harris is clearly identifying as an Indian American. It is crystal clear. So what is the problem? Are you really that delusional? Come on, wake up, black people. Listen to Kamala Harris herself admitting that she's Indian. She consented.
Okay, so what we're gonna cook today,
okay,
is an Indian recipe.
Yes.
Because
yes.
You are Indian.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, and I don't know that it because
yes.
You are
yes.
Indian.
Yes.
And she was only promoting Indian heritage. I didn't know she was black.
So you see it with your own eyes and you hear it with your own ears. She's clearly consenting and admitting that she is Indian. Now, suddenly, and then, you know, I can relate to Mr. Trump. She suddenly is now prescribing to be black because it is in her best interest to get the black vote. Nothing else. Nothing else. No other reason. Now, suddenly she wants to be black. And what the Democratic Party's strategy is to use the black female to help push this paradigm. And this is exactly what's going on. I know that you're mentally blind because of the injuries that has actually been inflicted upon your mental faculty, but it is time to awake from sleep. You may not like those words, but it still doesn't dissuade it from being truthful. The next thing that's obvious to just about every black American is that Indians do not associate with blacks in that particular manner. They do not consider themselves to be black. They specifically consider themselves to be Indian, despite how dark their skin may be. In fact, in India, there is this tendency to bleach their skin to look whiter, because that's associated with beauty. Now, I mean, these are harsh realities that people must face. And if you doubt what I'm saying, do some research on bleaching, skin bleaching creams in India. They do not like to associate with being black. And is it any wonder? I mean, when will you people learn to think for yourselves? At some point, the light should come on.
Until a number of years ago when she happened to turn black, and now she wants to be known as black. So I don't know, is she Indian or is she black?
She has always identified as a black woman. I respect either one.
Scott is obviously lying, which I will prove with the next clip that Kamala Harris. Specifically, as we see on the screen, her mother identifies herself as Caucasian, Indian. She doesn't want to be black. And like so, Harris clearly identifies on three different occasions openly as being Indian, not black.
Okay, so what we're going to cook today is an Indian recipe.
Yes.
Because you are Indian.
Yes.
Okay, I respect either one, but she obviously doesn't. Because she was Indian all the way, and then all of a sudden she made a turn and she went...
Rachel Scott also stated in the interview, Kamala Harris has actually always identified as being black. She went to a black college. Just because a white person attends a black college does not make them black. Now, I'm not calling Kamala Harris white, but her mother does identify as being Caucasian on her birth certificate. The point being taken, just because someone attends a black college doesn't make them black. So as we can clearly see here from the birth certificate, her mother's identifying as white. Why do you think Kamala Harris brought Megan Thee Stallion out on stage to teach young black girls to twerk? Was that a political expression, or was that an excellent example of a democratic political expression? To utilize the black community for whatever means they can be resourceful and then simply cast them to the side. You can only imagine the talk in the background about such a feat that Megan Thee Stallion pulled off before the entire world. Do you think that's very healthy to young black girls? Megan Thee Stallion teaching them to twerk on stage? For votes? Are you serious, Kamala Harris? Are you serious? Are you kidding me right now? Wow, what an example. Wow, what a role model. Megan Thee Stallion.
Certainly you could become the first Indian senator in U.S. history, which would be quite an accomplishment.
Not good.
As senator, we just heard Kamala Harris admit to being Indian. So what's the problem that everyone has with Mr. Trump speaking the truth? See, this is the thing, that the society has actually become so emotional and their mental faculties has actually become so manipulated that you cannot receive the truth in intellectualized conversations because you're so into your emotions. It's almost like all of you have lobotomies, right? And you're in need of assistance of some sort of mental therapy. Get your minds right, folks. The truth is the truth. And your emotional viewpoint is not going to alter the truth or make it untruthful. The truth is the truth, so let's embrace the truth. Now, do you want the truth or do you want the Democratic lie?
Now that you are asking black supporters to vote for you, why should black voters trust you after you have used language like that?
Well, first of all, I don't think I've ever been asked a question so... In such a horrible manner, first question. You don't even say, hello, how are you? Are you with ABC? Because I think they're a fake news network, a terrible network. And I think it's disgraceful that I came here in good spirit. I love the black population of this country.
Considering what you've seen here and heard here, I reiterate Mr. Trump's statement. I didn't know that she was black. Is she black or is she Indian? You decide. Based on Kamala Harris' own words, she clearly identifies as being an Indian American and not black. I contend that Donald Trump is a strong representation of a masculine man, which is why he openly speaks his mind. He speaks truth, and many people find it offensive. because in this particular society, a feminist agenda is being pushed behind Marxism and the other things that's actually in conjunction with the socialism. Well, and so men like Donald Trump are not wanting. So you either emasculate yourself, accept the social norm, or be ostracized by a system that considers any masculine man toxic masculinity. Stand up and be men again and stop going for the nonsense.
I stand before you as the first candidate for Vice President of the United States of South Asian descent.
Detach your emotions, witness the fact she's not black.
Earlier this week, speaking to a gathering of black journalists, former President Donald Trump questioned Vice President Kamala Harris's racial identity.
And now she wants to be known as black. So I don't know, is she Indian or is she black?
She has always
but
identified
you know
as a black woman.
I stand before you as the first candidate for Vice President of the United States of South Asian descent.
Mr. Trump and other Republicans have accused a politician of color of not knowing their own race or ethnicity.
You've witnessed in this video on three different occasions where Harris has literally referred to herself as other than black, as pretty much an East Indian, South Asian descent, nothing in regards to her so-called black heritage that she wants to associate with now that she's running for president. Black people, wake up. Wake up out of your deep sleeps. You're simply being used as a catalyst for her to try to get into office. It won't happen.
Okay, so what we're going to cook today is an Indian recipe.
Yes.
Because
yes.
You are Indian.
Yes, yes.
Okay, and I don't know.
I stand before you as the first candidate for Vice President of the United States of South Asian descent.
Certainly you could become the first Indian senator in U.S. history, which would be quite an accomplishment.
Not quite.
The conclusion is Kamala Harris is black when it's convenient for votes.